I want to talk about a new class of focusing crystal shapes for the Bragg spectroscopy of point-like X-ray sources in laser-produced plasmas, and I'm reporting work which we have done during the last few years in Princeton in collaboration with the X-ray group at the NIF facility. And I go to the next slide. I begin with the statement that the challenges for X-ray spectroscopy are enormous with respect to spectral resolution and photon throughput, and these demands can no longer be satisfied by the presently used standard crystal forms, flat crystals, spherical crystals, cylindrical crystals, conventional crystal toroids, or log spiral crystals. And therefore, an entire new focusing crystal forms have to be developed. These new crystal shapes must exactly satisfy the imaging condition for each wavelength in an extended wavelength range of 1 kilovolt, so that in order to enhance the photon throughput, the area of the crystal can be increased without the introduction of imaging errors. It goes to the next slide to demonstrate this. I choose the so-called extended X-ray absorption fine structure spectroscopy, which is becoming very important for studies of the state of matter under extreme condition in high energy density plasmas. What you see here is the transmission spectrum of an iron foil as a function of energy near the K edge at 7 kilovolt. And of interest is the fine structure which you see above the absorption edge. This fine structure is determined by the arrangement of the neighboring atoms to the X-ray absorbing atoms. That means it you can distinguish whether the arrangement of the neighboring atoms is in a crystalline configuration or more in a statistical configuration, which is typical for a fluid-like state. So what are the requirements to measure such a spectrum in great detail? You need extremely high spectral resolution of about 10 kilovolt for an extended spectral range of 1 kilovolt. And you need very high photon throughput in order to reduce statistical errors. And lastly, you also have to eliminate any source size broadening effects. And this last requirement means that you have to choose crystal forms where each crystal point is associated with a well-defined Roland circle, since source size broadening effects can be minimized by moving the detector onto a Roland circle. So next one. So how do we find new crystal shapes? For this purpose, we consider an arbitrary curve in the XY plane and assume that a point source is at the origin of that coordinate system. We further assume that an X-ray is emitted from the source under a polar angle phi, and that the incident ray hits the crystal. The curve is supposed to be the trace of a curved crystal, that the incident ray hits the curved crystal at a point where the slope angle is equal to alpha, and the Bragg angle is, as you see from the figure, equal to alpha minus phi. If you develop these equations, which are given here in this figure, you end up with a differential equation, which is given in one. And so any arbitrary curve can be described by such a differential equation. If you assume that the Bragg angle is constant, then you can immediately integrate this curve and you receive the so-called logarithmic spiral, or the well-known logarithmic spiral form, which is much used in X-ray spectroscopy because you can observe only one wavelength with the whole crystal. So if you are interested in such measurements, a log spiral is what may be useful. But in order to find additional solutions, we rewrite the equation in the following form, which is shown here in equation 3. And we have to make an assumption about the dependence of the angle alpha, the slope angle, as a function of polar angle phi. And we make the simple assumption that there is a linear dependence. This has the advantage that we can express the differential d phi in terms of the differential d alpha minus phi. And we can rewrite the equation in the form given in equation 5. And you see that we can immediately integrate this equation. And then we obtain the so-called sinusoidal spirals. Now, this is a class of curves which are simply determined by one parameter v. And that parameter can be varied from minus infinity to plus infinity. So you can choose all kinds of crystal curvatures just by varying one parameter. It turns out that the logarithmic spiral is obtained if v is equal to 1, which appears to be a singularity in the equation 6. So if we compare now, investigate v values in the neighborhood of 1, we obtain the following picture. The black curve is a logarithmic spiral, and the red curve is a sinusoidal spiral. And listed above is the polar angle phi, or several values of it, and the Bragg angle theta. You see that the Bragg angle varies with the polar angle phi. So if you choose b equal 0.9, you obtain this figure. And again, you see a variation of the Bragg angle theta. And finally, if you choose b extremely close to 1, you approximate the logarithmic spiral where the Bragg angle theta does not vary anymore. So so you can now choose the curvature of your crystal such that it reflects your range of interest, your spectral range of interest. So you can choose the right curvature for the range of Bragg angles you have. So next, the next important feature is to choose a proper three-dimensional extension of the two-dimensional curves, such that the imaging conditions are absolutely satisfied for each wavelength. And to illustrate the problem, I consider the geometry of a conventional torus with a major radius R equal OC and a minor radius PC. And also shown here is a Roland circle which passes to the crystal point C. In order to avoid source size broadening, we want that the image of the source is on the Roland circle. Now, for the geometry of a conventional torus, it turns out that the source must then also be on the Roland circle and exactly opposite to the image I. So and furthermore, you have to require that the interconnecting line between I and S1, the source position, passes through P, so that CP, which is the minor radius of the torus, is essentially the radius of the curvature up down from the drawing plane, and that the axis from S1 to I is an axis of rotational symmetry for the incident and reflected rays. So you see that for this particular position, you fulfill the imaging conditions exactly. If you move the source to a different position, S2, which is often done in experiments in order to increase the solid angle and the photon throughput, you disregard the geometry of the conventional torus and you introduce imaging errors, which in turn affect your spectral resolution. But there is a way to modify the conventional torus such that we still fulfill the exact imaging conditions. For this purpose, we connect the source S2 with the image I and define that line as an axis of rotational symmetry for the ray pattern. The radius of curvature is then CT, which that is the line segment which is perpendicular to this axis of rotational symmetry. And you again have fulfilled exactly the imaging conditions for this new source position. I go to the next. You can build a spectrometer design on this principle, and the principle is shown here. You have the source again. We call it a modified torus now. So the source hits the incident rays of different wavelengths, hit the crystal at different points. And we require that all the images are on the associated on the Roland circles, which are associated with the Bragg reflecting crystal. So then you define for each crystal point an axis of new axis of toroidal symmetry and a minor radius. And you see that the minor radius varies both in magnitude and in direction with respect to the major radius. So this is a design where the major radius is still constant, but the minor radius is no longer constant and varies along the crystal surface in magnitude and direction.
You're running into your question time. So you have another minute and 15 seconds left, which is your question time.
Okay, so then let me be very brief. This shows again, shows the same principle applied to a sinusoidal spiral, which has certain advantages. And these are results which I cannot explain in detail. What you observe, the two designs have the same dimensions, but you see that the imaging points, the green points, are spread much more in the case of a sinusoidal spiral. So you have a much higher dispersion, and I go to the bottom line. With design 2, you also obtain a very high spectral resolution of 20,000, which can practically not be realized. But it means that our spectral resolution is no longer limited by the spectrometer design. It is only limited by crystal properties. So I want
to... Okay, thank you.
Yeah, okay, fine.
Thank you very much. Let me see if a question, well, you've talked through your complete allotment of time, and I've been told I have to keep everybody...
Oh, I'm sorry.
I have to keep them all on schedule.
Yeah.
Can
I just show the last view graph?
Okay, and put the last one up, and I think they're going to be available afterwards.
Yeah, I just want to list my email address, and if there are further questions and discussions, I'm happy to answer those by email. So my email is bitter@ppl.gov.
Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your attention.